Very good afternoon. Sorry, my sound is not sweet today because I am throat pain. So, am I audible to all? So, Sandeep sir already explained different branches of geology. So, one of the important branches is marine geology. So, in marine geology, usually dealing with different origin of oceans, mineral deposits we can collect from, explore from the ocean. So I will be explaining different mineral deposits we can explore from the oceans and some of the general characteristics of the oceans. As we know that oceans are very important, isn't it? So we'll explain what are the basis oceans are so important to human beings. So if you see this slide, in Puranas also, Asuras and Suras, they used oceans for churning to get the elixir. So that is in Purana. But now, at present also in ocean, we are having a lot of valuable assets like gas hydrates, polymetallic nodules, even most of the oil fields that we can see is in ocean floor and placer deposits. So that means not only in ancient mythology, and now also we can explore a lot of mineral deposits we can see in the ocean floor. So before going through the different mineral deposits, some of the general statistics of the ocean. As we know that at present we have how many oceans? 4, 5, 6. So earlier we said there are 4 oceans, isn't it? Pacific, Atlantic, Arctic, Indian. So recently after 2000 we have included Southern Ocean. That southern part of the Pacific, Atlantic, Indian all comes under Southern Ocean. Earlier we consider our 4 oceans, Pacific, Atlantic, Indian and Arctic. So among these, which is the biggest ocean? Pacific. Followed by? Arctic is the smallest. Atlantic, Indian, Southern Ocean and Arctic. So the area, as we know that 71% of our land is covered by the ocean. And if you if you take the total water resources in our earth, 99% is in the ocean. So there are, if you see the ocean, there are some area of the ocean very very deeper. You might have heard Marina Trench, in the Pacific Ocean. There is a deepest valley, it's known as Marina Trench. So if you, that depth of this Marina Trench is how many kilometers? 11 kilometers. So that means in our land, like highest mountains we have, Mount Everest. What is the height of Mount Everest? 8,848 meters. The depth of the Marina Trench is 11,000. So suppose we are taking the Himalaya, putting the Marina Trench, still the ocean is so deep. So if you take the average depth of the ocean, it comes just 3,730. That is the average depth of the ocean. That means there are places like Marina Trenches, deepest shallows. This is just average. So this is a very important thing. What are the way oceans are important to us? So what are the way oceans are useful to us? Is to down the waste? Any other uses? This side? We are getting fish, today we have in lunch fish fry. So there are resources, living resources as well as non-living resources. Living resources is fishes, non-living resources, lot of mineral wealth are there. Can you name some mineral deposits in ocean? Salt, okay, we need salt, isn't it? Then, silica. So there are two important, I will be discussing two important deposits that we can potentially, now we are not started exploring, gas hydrates. Another one is polymetallic nodules. I will be discussing each one of these. So besides mineral deposits, we are also using ocean for transportation. Oil, major goods, they are transported by using ocean. So that is another important aspect. So other than that, we are using oceans for our recreation purpose, isn't it? Tourists, we are visiting beaches and opposing some gases. So besides this, ocean has one more role. Ocean control of weather and climate. Now we are getting monsoon, isn't it? Monsoon is nothing but a wind which carries water. What is the mechanism of monsoon? Why we are getting monsoon? Because the distribution land and ocean in such a way that the land acting as a low pressure medium. As a result, wind blowing from ocean coming to the land. Since the wind coming from ocean, it carries water. So our weather is controlled by ocean. So some of the advantages we are using ocean. So oceans, is it now we only classified there are 5 oceans. Is it like that in the form of the past also? No. You might have studied plate tectonics. There is a single ocean, isn't it? And a single continent. So there is a geological evolution of ocean. There is only single ocean. And see, you can in this picture, so you can note the position of India is in the southern hemisphere. So that is during 65 million years back, India's position is in the southern hemisphere. But now we are in northern hemisphere. So this, because of plate tectonics, Indian plate started moving towards up and collided with Eurasian plate. That is why the formation of Himalaya. So the evolution of ocean also is interesting. There is one ocean, and because of the changes in the distribution of land and ocean, at present we are having 5 big oceans. So what is the difference between oceans and seas? Is there any difference? So in the Indian Ocean we have Arabian Sea, Bay of Bengal, Andaman Sea. So why we call sea something called ocean? So usually seas are usually one of two or third part of the seas landlocked. That is why, and also having a small volume of water. And so in the land surface we are having valleys and hills, isn't it? Similarly, in ocean floor, we are having several hills and valleys. Like marina trenches. Instead of valleys, we are having trenches. Like gyros. In ocean floor, we are having mountains. If it is flat top mountains, we call it as gyros. Mid-oceanic ridges. The biggest ridge system is not in the land, it is in the ocean. Mid-oceanic ridges. 74,000 km long ridge system is there in the ocean. And it's almost similar to land. There are flat surfaces, hills, valleys, all we can see in the ocean floor. So this is the features of the ocean. You can see some of the sea mounds, valleys, abyssal plains. Abyssal plains are the deepest part of the ocean floor. There, you don't expect any penetration of sunlight. So sunlight will reach only the 200 meters of the water. So abyssal plain is greater than 2000 meters. And it is almost, this scale is not an actual scale. Because in abyssal plain itself is the 60% of the earth is abyssal plain. So this is for the dynamic scale. So here you can see different sea mounds, valleys, etc. So simply, ocean floor is similar to land. There are volcanoes also. In ocean also we can get a lot of volcanoes. More than land, volcanoes are found in ocean floor. Adjacent to mid-oceanic ridges, all there we can see a lot of volcanoes. And all these mountains are past volcanoes. This diorite soda, majority of them are past volcanoes. So, there is a big system in the ocean floor, people call it as mid-oceanic ridges. That is the longest ridge system. Throughout the center of the ocean, you can see that ridge system. So, some places it is exposed, like Iceland. Some other places are concealed within the water. So, it has having the 74,000 km length of the mid-oceanic ridge. So, that is the largest ridge system. So, what are mid-oceanic ridges? They have any geologically any importance, mid-oceanic ridges. They are the position of plate boundaries. What happens geologically, what happens between two plates, whether they are diverging, converging in mid-oceanic ridges? What happens in plate of poles? What happens? What is converging? Diverging?
So what happens in those oceanic crystals?
Divert, not convert.
Himalayas form to two.
Convert.
There are two plates collided. So if you see in the ocean only the 200 meter because of sunlight, like the deeper part, it's very dark. So because of that, there are a lot of organisms living in the 200 meter zone. We call it as planktonic. Planktonic organisms. They are living in the water column. Similarly, there will be some organism in the ocean floor. They are called it as bentonic organisms. But if you see the abundance, more abundance are planktonic organisms. And ocean floor, the temperature is sub-zero. It's not, the average temperature of the ocean is only 3 degrees Celsius. In equator region, you can expect 24, 27 degrees. But in polar region, it's freezing. The average temperature to take the ocean, it is only 3 degrees. And almost all the ocean floor, the temperature below sub-zero. So how geology study ocean floor? So since it's ocean floor, because water flow is there. So we have some, we need some vessels. We call it as research vessels. So India has several research vessels. One of the important research vessel is Sagar Kenya. So Sagar Kenya is equipped with different equipment, like the sights of scanner, gravity borer, graphs, net. So by using this research vessel, geologists, usually marine geologists, they go to the sea and take samples. So this is the research vessel of India. It's having nearly more than 100 meter length and 24 laboratories. And 56 scientists can accommodate. It's a big research vessel. Like South Korea, other countries also having research vessels. Like Joydas, you might have heard Joydas. Joydas, we call it as a floating university. It is a vessel made by different countries. So by using different instruments, we can measure like sonar, we can measure the depth of the ocean, what is the features present in the ocean floor. And by using some devices, we can collect the samples. This is known as graph. By using graph, we can collect surface samples from the ocean. By using core, we can get geological samples from the ocean. Usually, geologists take core samples from the ocean to understand the past geological condition. What happens in ocean floor? Sedimentation is a continuous process. But in land, sedimentation will take place only in days and it is not continuous. Maybe during monsoon time, we will get some sedimentation. But not monsoon time, there may not be any sedimentation. So no record. But ocean floor, the sedimentation is a continuous process. Either the indigenous materials or organisms living in the water column will, after their death, they will be fell in the ocean floor and part of the sediments. So it's like a history books. The bottom will represent past, surface will represent present. So geologists take this core sample to understand what happened in the geological past. So in this core sample, there will be several fossils. Can be micro fossils or mega fossils. By using the abundance of fossils, geology can explain what happened in the geological past. So this is the section of core samples. And we can also collect water samples by using an instrument called process of water sample. So each depth we can take the water and measure the salinity, temperature, all these parameters. So this is another research vessel. Some research vessels also having submersibles. Geologists can go by using submersibles will be there. They can dive deep in the ocean. So that is also possible. So if what do you think about this ocean water is stagnant or they are moving? In beaches, you might see movement waves. Not only that, ocean water is moving. You might have a conveyor belt. There is a big conveyor belt. All oceans are connected through this conveyor belt. In Arctic or Antarctic region, water is downwelling and they are upwelling in the equator plate. So as a result, the old, it is circulating all nutrients, whatever, it's effectively distributing to all over the ocean. And what happens in the equatorial region, we are having hot water. Polar region, we are having cold water. This conveyor belt taking cold water, downwelling and is upwelling. So it's a cycle. So this is the, this is known as thermo-ionic circulation, because the process of this circulation is caused by thermo and ion. What is thermo? Thermoregulation. Ion means salinity. So this circulation is controlled by changes in the temperature and salinity, because salinity has some different density. Salinity are giving more density to seawater as well as temperature. So because of this, this circulation distributing heat, nutrients everywhere. So now come to the mineral deposits. So there are different types of mineral deposits we can see in the ocean floor. So some of the mineral deposits, before that, explaining mineral deposits, because you know that who owns the ocean. For India, we are having oceans, isn't it? Pakistan, do they have an ocean? Indian Ocean is for India? No. So in ocean, since only some countries are having the ocean, so there is a rule. United Nations control these oceans. So each country will get only limited part. We call it as EEZ. That is 200 nautical miles only, that's the right of that particular country. All other open ocean is owned by international, under United Nations Organization, International Seabed Authority. So we cannot go in the deep ocean and collect the minerals. So we have to get the permission from United Nations. And suppose for India, India is exploring a region in the Central Indian Ocean Basin. There is 150,000 square kilometer area. There we are having polymetallic nodules. Polymetallic nodules are nodules which are seen in the ocean floor, like potato-like material, which contain manganese, copper, nickel, cobalt, etc. So India is applied to UN and UN permitted to explore this region, but the problem is that if India gets 100%, 50% profit, we have to deposit to UN. So UN will be distributing that profit to other landlocked countries. So this is known as law of the sea. So EEZ is the area that is 200 nautical miles. So this region is known as EEZ. That is, that region has the right of that particular nation. But even this, we have to get permission from United Nations. So here some area we are having white EEZ. What is the reason? Some see, here we can see white EEZ. Here also very white EEZ. EEZ means 200 nautical miles from the land. Because we are having some high rise, isn't it? Because of that, like Andaman also you get more place because we are having high rise. This is polymetallic nodules. So that is an important mineral resource seen in the ocean floor. But problem is that deep ocean, that is the water depth is 5 km. So they are very economically important. At present, it is not feasible to mine because the cost for exploring this is very high. Because at present, our land is rich in manganese. We have enough iron, so we don't have to go for deep ocean. But future, polymetallic nodules will be a good reserve. And there are three minerals rich in polymetallic nodules. We call it as Ukoni, copper, cobalt, nickel. Their concentration is very high. At present, our resources is depleting in the land. So future, already Japan started mining polymetallic nodules. India not yet started. There are some because it's very expensive. Deep ocean, the mineral resources are 5 km below the ocean. So on deep.
Assemble a deep sea bed manganese nodule recovery processing system using low risk, commercially available equipment and technology. The company will draw on its parent company, Lockheed Martin, to leverage the system architecture of the 1980s. This was in part developed and approved by a Lockheed led consortium in the 1970s, which invested $500 million. In addition to operational seabed experience, the 1970s work also resulted in the discovery of thousands of geolocated nodule mineral samples. Here we see a potential scenario based on applying modern technology and bring forward the legacy Lockheed Martin system. Other alternatives will be evaluated in line with exploration results and environmental considerations, which are paramount. Efficient seabed to surface nodule recovery can be achieved by multiple deep sea nodule collectors, slurry transfer lines and pump, and state-of-the-art rising pumps. This process will deliver nodules for surface shift from where they will be transported to a metallurgical process. Multiple nodule collectors, scooping the nodules from the sea floor and transferring them as slurry to the central pump, will be at the heart of the system. Equipment of similar 100 ton size is already operational today for deep sea cable trenching and pipeline. Deep sea vehicles already available can also be employed to connect collectors to the central pump. The multiple collectors and central slurry pump together provide a constant flow of nodules through the rising to the surface. On board the surface ship, the nodule slurry is pumped to dynamic.
Since then, more than 200 have been seen on the deep sea floor.
and we detected signs of at least 500 sensitives. They chuck out a clue in the reach. The fluid was different to see. We can detect that with something a bit like water spoke. And we still have a lot of interesting tools and data. But these deep sea vents are an important part of how our planet works. They're the end product of signals circulating in new crust for water. Now, I'm a marine biologist. What I'm excited about these is that they support colonies of deep sea creatures in otherwise quite sparse colony abyss. Yet the rich races, populations of deep sea creatures, thrive in deep sea vents because mineral-rich food in industrial vents is an energy source for microbes. Deep sea vents, to me, are just like islands, living islands of life. More than 400 new species of animals have been described in this particular mission of the literature. That's actually, that's 2006. If you do sums, I think that's a pretty average. These are so I've been working at one location.
So what is the importance of hydrothermal vents? There are also we can get lot of sulfide minerals. And one interesting thing is that you might have seen lot of life forms, worms, plants, how they are living there. The temperature of that area is more than 100 degrees Celsius and there is no sunlight. So still, we can see a lot of organisms living in such environment. And interesting thing is that this is discovered very recently in 1981. Before that, we already landed in moon everywhere, but in our own planet, ocean, still we are not explored. So this organism, they cannot do photosynthesis, isn't it? There is no sunlight condition. And temperature is very high. Still, how those organisms are survive, how they make their food? Any idea? That environment is rich in different types of organisms. So that is, they do chemosynthesis, not photosynthesis. They are chemical. Through some chemical reaction, they make their food. So these are the organisms that we can see in the hydrothermal vents. So another important deposits which I want to say is gas hydrates. You heard about gas hydrates. So that is the future. You want to say that is the future fuel. Now we know that our fossil fuels are depleted. So the future fuel is known as gas hydrates. Gas hydrates are nothing but they are gas deposits which contain methane, trapped methane. So we can use them as energy. So we can see only in the ocean floor.
Decomposing to ice plus gas.